our elders were very proactive when it came to education, of course, in the cultural context. We all have to learn, but now there was this new educational system, this new way of life, unfortunately, characterized by assimilation. We couldn't be both. We couldn't be bicultural. You had to give up who the identity, the history, the culture, the language of who you had been for thousands upon thousands of years, and just automatically make a transition and become like those who came to live with us, to speak their language, to live as they do, to adopt their ways of life. And of course, our leaders, our grandparents, were very reality-based, and they knew that some of us would have to go to school. And for some of those that attended those first off-reservation boarding schools, as you stated, some of the prisoners, rather than come home to Indian Territory, went north. There were some of them, I think 17 of them, sent to Hampton Institute in Virginia. And Hampton Institute was founded by a man by the name of Samuel Armstrong as a boarding school for freed black slaves. And so Pratt put about 17 of the prisoners at Hampton. And then after a while, he decided, for better or for worse, these Indians shouldn't be educated with anybody else. They should have their own schools. And so in 1879, he established Carlisle Indian Industrial Training School. And some of the Fort Marion prisoners were in that first class. And of course, they helped him recruit. Okrahader helped Pratt recruit for Carlisle by coming back here to Indian Territory. But the thing about it is those schools were aimed solely at assimilation. And of course, we've heard the slogan of we've heard the slogan that rather characterizes Pratt and Carlisle and those off-reservation boarding schools that he is looked at as the father of, the father of the off-reservation boarding school system. But his primary slogan was, kill the Indian, but save the man, which is just another way of saying complete, total annihilation of one's culture, total assimilation. And that was what he wanted. They were a part of that great experiment. I think maybe we're still a part of that great experiment. We have not grappled yet with providing bicultural education to our young people in a way that is just a regular part of the school system. Maybe at the college level, we may have done a little bit better by having Native American studies programs where students have the option of studying their own history, their languages, their cultures, and ways of life. But we've got a long ways to go. Let's stop and look at the years upon years, beginning in 1875, with the Fort Marion prisoners to today, where we were expected to just completely, totally assimilate into the Vail culture and forget who we are as Cheyennes, as Arapahos, as this country's indigenous population. Our languages, unfortunately, bore that frontal assault of assimilation. And that is something that we must be very proactive about, making sure that we retain those languages, because languages are a part of culture. They're intertwined, and culture is a part of language. And so it began with our ancestors at Fort Marion.